Well, I'm glad to be here. As a new director of SPRU, and I would like to welcome you to the event today. We will talk about the future of innovation policy. And one thing to understand is that we need to get innovation policy and innovation out of the ghetto of science and technology. It's a lot more. We also need to acknowledge, of course, at the same time that innovation, you know, to talk about innovation, we need to look also at the limitations of what you can do with innovation. But in any case, it's clear that innovation policy is about the central issues of our time. It's about economic growth, it's about jobs, it's about climate change, it's about democracy. It's also about the future of our energy, communication, and transport infrastructures. It's about education, it's about healthcare. So innovation covers all these big issues. And then we should also understand, of course, that innovation policy, it's understandable, is hard work. It's not a neutral area, it is an area full of conflict, power struggles, difficult trade-offs. And we cannot harmonize all the perspectives, but we need to manage and work with all the tensions. And that's an important feature of innovation policy that is often neglected. Today I want to share with you where I see SPRU's place in these important debates as we are rapidly approaching our 50th anniversary, as James reminded us already in 2016. We organized this event to talk about the future of innovation policy and the future of SPRU. And these two have always been fused and should be fused in the future too. Having come from the Netherlands 8 months ago, I'm impressed by the critical mass of scholarship in the UK and also by the absorptive capacity of the political system to work with scholars. So I think the UK is well placed to develop a new type of innovation policy. And to this, I hope SPRU will contribute, and I also hope that I can contribute personally. Because what brings me pleasure and what are my qualities is that I'm an historian, so I like to bring a long-term perspective. I like to cross boundaries. As an historian, I worked with the sciences and engineering. I worked with the social sciences. And I also like to develop new concepts and new ideas. So I think SPRU is an excellent place for me to be, and I hope I can add value to the UK issues and the future of innovation policy. As an historian, of course, I'm used to work on long-term time scales. At the same time, I recognize that there are important issues and immediate milestones. For example, next week we will see President Juncker and his new commission taking up their new desk in Brussels. And this is an interesting time, because on the one hand, with the Horizon 2020 program, there is a clear focus on so-called grand challenges, social issues. At the same time, there's the notion of responsible research and innovation, which is promising. The question is, how will it be used and deployed? Because if you look at the actual policies, in fact, there's a lot still of old-style R&D-focused policy. So there's a gap, I would argue, between the rhetoric and the practice. But we have to wait and see what will happen. Well, in the UK, 6 weeks from now, as part of the autumn strategy statement, the UK government is expected to release its strategy on science and innovation. And within 6 months, we will have elections. And of course, UKIP, migration, the future of healthcare, all these issues will be very important. But I think innovation, hopefully, will be important too. And at least it's an important moment to talk about innovation. And in this context, we're certainly looking forward to hearing from Liam Byrne later today on Labour's vision for innovation in this country. But beyond these immediate political milestones, I believe that we should look more deeply at the shifts in the context for innovation. I would argue that the world is in transition. How do we know this is the case? Well, I could point to the persistent economic crisis and to the fact that future generations will be worse off most likely than their parents. I could also refer to the steep rise in inequality and to the squeeze of the middle class out of their jobs. This is part of a digital revolution which has just started and whose massive impact is still ahead of us. We also see a slow but steady hollowing out of the powers of the nation state. So that leads to the question whether it makes sense to have a national innovation policy at all. And we can also look at the movement away of the center of the world from the West. So the question is, for the future, will the future be made not here, but somewhere else? In any case, we can see new type of markets emerging, for example, in the East, that will really shape innovation in the future. But for me, these trends are important, and they're indicators, but the most basic issue is that we have a number of persistent problems. And these persistent problems have to do with the fact of the how we deal with the basic needs in our society. Because we have created systems of provision for food provision, mobility, energy, water, healthcare. And I believe, given climate change, we cannot globalize our current systems of provision. So if we want to provide the world in the future with their basic needs, we need to change all the systems in place. And we have to realize that we need to do this in a period when there will be more turmoil. Because when we talk about sustainable development, we often forget to talk about war, tensions. And also when we talk about innovation policy, we tend to forget that. But we're moving towards a world which will be more in turmoil. So the basic point is we cannot solve these problems through just a business as usual approach. We need to go to a new type of approach which aims at transformative change. So the challenge is, can we create an innovation policy, not just for innovation, but for transformative change? But why should we address transformative change through innovation policy at all? Well, there are two reasons for this. One is, innovation is implicated in all the major problems of today. It's part of the problem. It should also be part of the solution. But there is a more fundamental reason. That is that it's part of our modern society that we believe innovation can really solve social problems. We believe in it. It will bring wonderful things. So therefore, we often tend to forget the darker side of innovation. And too often, innovation policy is based on a technology push approach. The idea, we support R&D, we support innovation, that will lead to economic growth. And we tend to forget about the negative impacts, or we deal with them retrospectively, after the fact, through regulation. So we have a system where, on the one hand, we trust the market, helped by the government, to create innovation, and at the same time, we need the state who is responsible for the distribution of effects and the positive benefits, and also has to do the risk management. So there's a kind of split responsibility. And in this picture, people are mainly seen as consumers or as voters, but nothing more. I think we are in the need of a new social contract for what we could call a second modernity, in which we need to keep our ability to innovate, because this is the big invention of modernity, the ability to innovate, but we need to find new ways of directing innovation and embedding innovation into socially desirable directions from the outset, early on. So we should not first stimulate innovation and then afterwards care about the impact. No, we should deal with the impacts up front. And it should not only be the firms and the state who work on innovation policy, but also consumers as users, so not just as passive consumers, but as proactive users, and also citizen and civil society. If we accept that the core problems of the world in transition can be and should be addressed through innovation policy, the next question is, of course, how should such a policy look like? Based on ongoing work within SPRU and beyond, I believe that innovation policy should basically do two things. On the one hand, stimulate investment of many actors, investments a lot more than R&D, and provide direction. It should stimulate investment throughout the entire innovation chain. Not just invention, but also innovation and diffusion. We need to think about how can we help to re-engineer all technology, current systems. For example, energy efficiency is an area where we really need to work on improving current systems, not just new systems. We also need to work on the development of new services, new organizational models, business models to meet social as well as economic challenges. And we need to ensure that all actors benefit from innovation, not just firms, but also the state and the public. As SPRU's Mariana Mazzucato has emphasized in her work, pathbreaking work on entrepreneurial state, it's essential to see that innovation generates highly unequal risks and benefits for different actors involved. And I'm sure we will hear more about this from Mariana this afternoon. But secondly, and that's also very important, innovation policy should try to provide direction, which is difficult. But it should begin with opening up innovation portfolios, allowing consideration of a greater diversity of options, but without falling back too easily on polarized for or against. For example, if you think about energy, there are many options, but the debate is very polarized. Instead, innovation policy should allow for more exploration and experimentation outside the narrow boundaries often set by incumbents, with scientific advice based on a wider range of perspectives, and nurture a policy-making process which provides an opportunity for various stakeholders to challenge dominant and less dominant views. Innovation policy involves fundamental political questions, which, as Andy Stirling argues, present crucial areas for democratic deliberation. So innovation also has the potential to reinvigorate the future of our fragile democracies, a crucial theme which Andy Stirling may expand upon later today. But how then can innovation policy help to provide direction? I would like to propose four options. Not as a comprehensive set, but just as a way to fire the imagination. Firstly, foresight. Secondly, experimentation. Fourthly, new innovative institutions. Fourthly, fusing a wide range of expertise. Let's take foresight. SPRU was a pioneer in foresight studies thanks to the work of Ben Martin and others. And there's no doubt that foresight is difficult. The non-linear nature of technical change means new developments will occur in ways which could not be foreseen. To overcome this problem, foresight should be organized as a continuous effort across the entire innovation chain, from invention to wider diffusion, involving both social as well as technical processes. We need to use foresight more effectively as an instrument to giving voice to a wide range of expectations and aspirations about the future, and for orienting and directing investment decisions. So it should not be disconnected from the real investment decisions. In the past year, there's been a lot of emphasis on foresight capacity and horizon scanning in the UK. But we are yet to see how the new chief advisor, science advisor, Mark Walport, will shape the foresight function over his term. But I will leave it to Sandy Thomas to potentially reflect on these issues in her remarks. Secondly, we need to experiment more and on a larger scale with new emerging technologies. There's no lack of demonstration projects and pilots with new technologies. However, they are often organized ad hoc and they focus on technical challenges. and they leave it to the market to commercialize and standardize solutions. They are often not geared towards exploring and exploiting how new technologies present opportunities for addressing societal challenges, and then how to capture value in a later stage of the innovation chain. So we need to allow for bigger experiments, build more connections between the various experiments, and focus on experimenting with societal impacts too. Perhaps innovation policy should provide a consortium of actors, including market, state, and civil society ones, a license to experiment with new solutions on a large scale and for a long time period. And of course, we need to talk about the conditions for such a license. Thirdly, innovation policy should nurture the development of a new kind of institutions which bring together state, business, academia, and wider societal actors. These institutions should facilitate discussion and negotiation on the direction of innovation. In our current system, such institutions are really lacking. We have institutions for promotion of new technologies, for example, the Technology Strategy Board in the UK. And on the other hand, we discuss impacts, and we have institutions for controlling and regulating the negative impacts. But what is missing is an institutionalized process to facilitate societal learning and create a culture in which responsibilities for the impacts of innovation can be shared across all actors. Fourthly, we need to fuse a wide range of expertise. Recent SPRU research by colleagues, including Alex Cote, Paul Nightingale, Maria Savona, and Josh Siepel, concluded that firms become highly innovative not when they get R&D support, for example, but when they incorporate science and engineering graduates into the workforce. So education is key. And in another report, Paul Nightingale and Roberto Camerani and colleagues argued for the importance of combining creative arts, design skills, and technology expertise, and showed how precisely this fusion, the fusion of these elements, made the Brighton Digital Cluster so successful. So to create successful innovations, science and engineering and business schools need to go beyond specialist career paths and develop a new generation of leaders who understand the need to work in interdisciplinary teams and combine technological and social aspects in order to innovate. Over the last decades, our field, innovation studies, we have been developing building blocks for a new innovation theory, which goes beyond the Schumpeterian understandings on which current innovation policies are often still based. So time has come, I think, to build a new innovation theory from all these building blocks, to combine economics of innovation, science and technology studies, technology management, and other fields into a new synthesis. And this synthesis should rethink the role of the state and civil society in innovation policy. It should incorporate the role of demand, the role of users, the role of grassroots innovation, and their role in transformative change. And this is also currently explored by the Center on Innovation and Energy Demand, hosted at SPRU, for an important issue of the future of our energy supplies. And it should also become, that's also very important, a tendency we should work towards overcoming our Eurocentric bias and link up to new findings in global studies and innovative work on development, as is currently undertaken, among others, in the STEP Center, run by SPRU and IDS. But time has come not only to develop a new theory, but also to implement these new insights into innovation policies and practices. For too long, we have accepted a gap between insights of innovation theory and practice. We need a new fuse, if I can borrow that word, between both. Innovation policy needs to be transformed. And in this process, innovation researchers should be very actively involved in various roles, as co-designers, as well as developers of new ways of assessing quality and impact. Innovation policies can only flourish when business leaders, technology experts, and policymakers have been confronted with new innovation insights during their studies and in other settings. SPRU will therefore invest more in teaching, executive programs, master programs, as well as in undergraduate programs in the School of Business, Management, and Economics. We see this as a major avenue for having impact in this world in transition. Building on the rich tradition established by our founders, Chris Freeman, Jeff Oldham, Keith Peffett, Marie Yehuda, and many others, and on the rich diversity of current activities, I believe that SPRU is in an excellent position to contribute both to the development of a new innovation theory as well as to the much-needed transformation of innovation policy. We are well placed also in a university proud of its interdisciplinary legacy and with a strong commitment to policy impact. So as we look ahead to our 50th anniversary, we are embarking on a new ambition strategy, provisionally called Transformative Change and Innovation. This will include the building of a large new collective research program where we will not be responding to a call of a research council, but we will develop it ourselves together with partners in the UK and beyond. We will also work on developing new teachings program. And finally, we will reach out to our alumni again, not only to recognize and celebrate their contributions in the past, but also to engage with them, because many SPRU alumni are in influential and powerful positions, to engage them in a discussion and work with them on the future of the innovation policy. Our world is in transition, and it's facing grim, difficult, and urgent problems. We are not in a position to stay complacent. A sense of urgency is necessary, without, however, nurturing fear, since, as Andy Stirling has argued, this closes down debate and leads to bad solutions. During his entire life, Chris Freeman embraced an economics of hope, which embodies a positive view of the potential of mankind to use its resources constructively. I hope today is just the beginning of a discussion in this spirit about transformative change and innovation. Thank you.